Ladies and gentlemen, thank you for watching Kagadi TVUG today. We have brought you the IARA Member of Parliament, Honorable Dennis Namara Bindeba. He's live with us. He's going to share with us his political experience, his lifestyle, biography, and whatever. Mr. Dennis, greet our viewers and welcome to Kagadi TVUG.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much, my brother. My name is Dennis Namara. I'm born over here, Rutete. Here, as you can see, we're at my home, in Rutete here. I'm happy to be live on our TV, which has been initiated by our young brains from Kagadi. I'm very grateful. As you know, I'm a member of parliament representing Uganda at the regional parliament of East Africa, which is called the East African Legislative Assembly. And I'm a born of Kagadi, born and bred here.
Yes.
Thank you very much.
Kagadi, if someone is in Kenya, Tanzania, want to find Kagadi, where is Kagadi located for sure, if you want to direct him that you are from Kagadi?
Yeah, Kagadi is one of the new districts in Midwestern Uganda, which is bordering with Lake Albert, yeah, it's not very far from here, but it's one of the districts in Bunyoro sub-region, Midwestern Uganda, and it's one of the new, powerful and upcoming districts in the entire country.
Mr. Dennis, your lifestyle, your historical biography, by the way, starting from education, where you study from primary, secondary, tertiary, university, and or whatever.
Thank you very much. You know, I was actually born in Kagadi here, sometime 1983. That's when I was born, and those are 37 years ago. That's when I was born. So I started from our schools here in Kagadi. Yes. I was jumping from one school to another when I was young. I started from Kagadi Muslim Primary School here,
Kagadi
town.
Yes.
The other time I would go to Bishop Ruakaikara. Mm-hmm. I also started from there, and then I went up to Kagadi Modo Primary School up to Primary 5, and then I was transferred because I was performing so well. I was always number one. So my father said, "Why do you want to? You got to compete with the other people and we see if you can challenge them." So he transferred me up to St. Bernadette in Hoima. In 1995 and 1997, I completed my primary 7. When I was at St. Ben, I was always I was head prefect actually at St. Bernadette Primary School, both P6 and P7, which has never happened someone to be head prefect in P7.
Mm.
But from I was there for 2 years as head prefect, I got a first grade. We were only 4 people in that school that year who got in 1997 who got first grade. I was one of those that got a first grade, and then I came in my senior one, started from Zika Foundation School, which was just starting in secondary. My senior one, also because I was performing very well, always number one, my father said, no, you man, I have to challenge you. You can compete with other people to see if you can perform better. He took me to Kabalega Boys Secondary School for my senior 2 at Form 4, and at Form 5, 6, I went to St. Henry's College Tovu in Masaka, where I completed my Form 6. And where at Kabalega, I was also a leader. I was actually a minister of security, whom they call secretary for security affairs, to ensure there is peace and harmony in the school. Form 5, I wanted everyone at school in Form 5 wanted me to be head prefect. But because I was focusing, I wanted to be a lawyer. And I knew if I did politics in Form 5, it would disorganize my performance.
Which combination do you took in Erev?
I did HEG D. And remember, by the way, I had come from Kabalega, which is from Bunyoro here.
Yes.
And I was competing now with people who are from Budo in Form 5 and 6, from Budo, from all these powerful schools, St. Mary's College, Chisubi, Namiriango. So I had to focus on how I would read my books. And fortunately, by the way, what is very good is that when I reached that St. Henry's College, from the day I stepped in senior 5, I was always number one. I was performing exceptionally very well, but I had a problem with my handwriting.
You're like a lawyer.
Yeah, in Form 6, they took me They brought me a teacher to teach me how to write.
Yee.
Because my handwriting was very poor.
It was poor.
And the reason was, we had not had the background of nursery.
Okay.
Here in Kagadi, we started from P1 and continued.
What they teach handwriting?
Handwriting is taught in nursery. So I had not had that background, but good enough, I was performing so well.
How many points do you got in A-level?
I got 23 points in my A-level.
So by then, the average was at how many?
25.
That
time it was 25.
You missed just 2 points.
But I was actually supposed to get 25. But I think the pressure was too much on me. Because everyone expected me to get 25 last time.
So, academically, Mr. Dennis, you are a bright man.
Of course, without a doubt. So, from there, I went and did law at Makerere University for 4 years. That's where my serious political journey began. Because as soon as I reached there at Makerere University in my second year, I stood to be a member of the parliament of the university.
Yes.
What they call GRC of Lumumba Hall. And I was lucky that I won. But before that one, I had stood for president of Makere Law Society. And I was cheated, by the way. I didn't know they were rigging the politics until that time. This is someone who I contested with. There's no way he would have defeated me. But because I was very clear, I didn't want to go into politics of cheating. The young man cheated me and became a president. People were very hurt. People cried because I had lost. But I knew my political journey had begun. So I stood for GRC. I became a member of parliament of the university. Upon being a member of parliament, I was elected to be the speaker of Makerere University for the Students Guild. So I became a guild speaker and we did a lot of work. That was the regime of my sister, Abo Susan, who was in DP. But then she was in DP. By that time, I was not even politically very serious in which political party. I was, of course, NRM. At the university, there were many issues. Others were FBC, others were DP,
UPC.
So I became a Speaker of Parliament. I actually won by 4 votes, a difference of 4 votes.
At the university?
At the university. I had about, I think 60 something, and my opponent had less of my votes by four votes. It was a very hotly contested election. Upon that one, I formed what they called the inter-university speakers panel. And then we had what they called the Union of Ugandan Universities Guild Parliament. So I brought all universities of Uganda together, the guild parliaments of all universities, under the patronship of General Eri Tumwine. General Eri Tumwine was our patron. And he was always connecting us with the president. Within 1 year, we had more than 4 meetings.
Where with the president?
Yes, and he came at Wuma Showground. We would bring all students, all leaders from all universities and other institutions, right from north, east, central, west, everywhere. And we'd have a meeting of minds to discuss the future of the politics of Uganda, of the young people. And after that one, I stood for what they call WUNSA, Uganda National Students Association. I became the president of all students.
So you are the one who had the idea of the association?
No, WUNSA is always there. It has been there. It is there by law, actually.
Okay.
And the patron is the president of the Republic of Uganda. So I stood to be the president of WUNSA. I won again, and the president was our patron. By then, I was at RODC. I was at the university, Makerere University. I was completing my Makerere University, and after WUNSA, now I went into the national politics now.
So when
that's when I stood to be the chairman of the Youth League of the NRM in the entire Uganda.
So where did you get the idea of, like, let me represent the youth?
One is that naturally every person you find, naturally every man, naturally man is a political animal.
Yes.
So if you have those genes, if you have the traits of being a leader, you'll find that there is always something that will be pushing you. Even the young people themselves, the students in the entire country, they would be pushing, say, you man, look here, you have brought all of us together. Why don't you be the president of all of us in the entire country?
So before that, Mr. Dennis, where do you get the school fees? Because at the university, you're running different things. You are entering into politics. What that idea? Where do you get the money for politics?
Even right from the university, I was very serious. Because I remember in my second year, together with my colleague, is called Chris, he's a lawyer, Chris Nwaninda. we had businesses ranging from saloons at the university.
At the university?
Yes, ranging from saloons, from video libraries. Then we had these public payphones. In my second year, we started, we bought two public payphones with my colleague Chris, where we're earning 20,000
a day.
Per day. Each of them would give us 10, so we're earning 20,000 per day. But our business collapsed because one of our friends started a business.
There's some business.
The cheaper public payphones and put it below 200, below 300. So we found ourselves we're out of business because this the public payphones were charging. You could not charge below 300. Now, for me, we brought cheaper ones where it was charging around 200 per unit. Automatically, we ran out of business. But we had many things we were doing at the university, so it was not very difficult for me to get some little money to run my political interests.
So your father followed you in that journey. Was he knowing about what you were doing, or he didn't knew that? He knew maybe he knew that you were at school just.
My father, of course, he knew that I was at school. First of all, my father is not a man who likes politics. And he didn't want a lot of politics. He wanted me to focus on education. But again, for me, I had another mind. And you know, politics is shaped at the university. If you are not shaped at the university, then it is difficult to be a very serious politician. So I became now the chairman of the Youth League of the National Resistance Movement in 2010.
How did you come to that post? How was the journey?
It was very tough, by the way. Because I'm someone who campaigned in the entire country.
The entire country.
And moved. I remember I had a small car. Then we would move with fuel in the boot, jerrycans of petrol from Karamoja without even a wheel spanner. I don't know what was. We had no wheel spanner, we had no jack, but we would move. I would campaign from north, east, central, everywhere. So, no one knew me, surprisingly, by the way, that time, that the Namara is running. That time, Right Honorable Mambabas was the Secretary General, and some people thought that I was his son. So he's saying, the son of Mambabas is running, but he actually did not know me.
Yes.
Seriously, he did not even know that this, he actually got to know me when I had won, and when he had won, and he had a part at his home, and I had gone there to share with him, to congratulate him. As the national, he said, hey, you are the young man they are calling my son. So yes, I'm the one. So I became a member of SEC, Central Executive Committee of the party, and we had many chances of being with the president, meeting the president. We did a lot of work, of political work. I think our youth league was extremely vibrant, by the way, during our time. Very, very vibrant, and also very controversial at the same time. So after being the member of SEC, the president, I actually stood for EALA, this position. I first stood for it in 2012.
2012?
Yes, where I lost by one vote. Just one vote. And after that one, the president appointed me as a senior presidential advisor in charge of youth. That position is equivalent to a cabinet minister.
So, Mr. Dennis, who is connecting you? Because from primary, secondary, university, on different posts, so now youth, now presidential advisor. Maybe you had someone for sure.
Not at all, not at all. I didn't have anyone, actually. But I would always contest and win. I would always contest and win because I would give the best ideas to the young people, to the students, to the youth. And they would vote me on the basis of my ideas. Even in 2012, when I stood for EALA, no one knew me, by the way, until the door voting, when I gave a speech. That's when people said, no, how, we cannot fail to have this young man in parliament.
So a man from Kagadi now entering State House, the presidential advisor.
Yes, so I became a senior presidential advisor, a position equivalent to that of a cabinet minister. Of course, as you know, in 2015, I stood for parliament here in this constituency. I was not very lucky to have won that time.
Yes.
So I after that I stood for member of parliament again of EALA in 2017, and I won. I was lucky that I won on the basis of my performance. Actually, I was elected without any doubt on the basis of my performance. In terms of, they would say, you talk to us, what do you want to do for us? Then I would give a speech for 5 minutes, and by the time I finished my speech, everyone was convinced that indeed Namara deserves to go to our regional parliament.
So currently, Dennis, in Uganda, we normally hear that if you don't have money, you cannot enter into politics. Politics is all about money. If you are not financially stable, for sure you cannot have any position in Uganda due to whereby you run activities using money.
Yes.
How was your financial status on that post of EALA?
when I was running, actually, I didn't have money. I didn't have money. Because remember, I'd just finished an election here of the constituency, which was very expensive. So I did not put in more than 20 million in that position to be elected as a member of parliament. And this 20 million was just for coordination, holding meetings. If you're calling members of parliament, of course, you have a meeting where to meet them from and you speak to them about your agenda. So I did not have money. But by God's grace, because one of my political journey, I had been a youth leader of the ruling party. So many of the members of parliament knew me, first of all. Cabinet ministers knew me. The president knew me very well. I'd been a member of SEC. And by God's luck, when I stood, I gave a very good speech. And the members of parliament elected me to represent Uganda at that level at the regional parliament. And as I speak now in parliament, I've been elected to be the chairperson of the budget committee, what we call the general purpose committee. So for the next 2.5 years, I'll be chairing the budget sessions of the East African community to come up with the budgets. That budget committee is called the general purpose committee. It has a lot of committees in it, more than, actually it's the biggest and most powerful committee of the assembly, because it has health, it has education, it has youth, it has women. So many, more than 10 committees bungled up in one. But the most important one is the budget role, because we consider and pass a budget for the community after it has been adopted by the Council of Ministers. It is brought on the floor of Parliament. Then the Speaker forwards it to my committee of general purpose to consider it and bring a report to Parliament for debate and approval.
So, Mr. Dennis, you are representing Uganda in East African Legislative Assembly. How is Uganda for sure? A Ugandan want to know, how are we benefiting for you representing us in East African Legislative Assembly? What are we benefiting from there?
Very good. That's a very good question. Number one, what is East African community in the first place?
Yes.
This is a community that brings together the 6 partner states, Uganda, Kenya, Tanzania, Rwanda, Burundi, and South Sudan. Why do we have to come together? For our own survival. There's no way, as the people of East Africa, we can afford not to be united. It's impossible. The United States of America, if you look at the United States of America, it united because it was a necessity for their survival. If you take an example of Italy, the unification of Italy, the unification of Germany,
yeah.
Yes, for all of them to come together for their own survival. So, for us as the people of East Africa, we have no choice, actually. As the people of Africa, we have no choice. Number one, for liberal political reasons, but for economic reasons. What do we do in East Africa? One is that we have to ensure there's free trade among the people of East Africa. You have seen my maize here in the store.
Yes.
Now, if I have these tons and thousands of tons of maize, and I don't have a market here, where can I sell my maize? I have to ensure I can sell my maize in Rwanda or in South Sudan or in Kenya, Tanzania, Burundi, without any taxes being imposed on my products. That's one of our roles as a East African community. So, how is Parliament involved? Parliament is involved in making laws to ensure there's a free movement of trade, free movement of goods. People are able to move in the whole of East Africa without any hindrance. It's one of the biggest principles of our integration, economic integration.
Yes.
To ensure there are no customs, there are no trade barriers amongst our partner states, so that people can trade freely, can move freely, can even go and marry freely, you know, in all those countries if they want. They can establish homes, they can have jobs across the entire East Africa without any hindrance. Of course, there are challenges there, but we are working on them to ensure we remove what they call the non-tariff barriers, NTBs.
Don't you think, Mr. Dennis, that this integration it favors people who have money, who are aware of, who have cargoes? Now, a mere person like me in Kagadi, really, how can I benefit from here? Can I also take my some goods in Rwanda, in
yes,
Kenya?
Yes. Actually, even before you reach there, one of you know these people from Rwanda, they have been coming and buying goods from here direct, even here rotate.
Yes.
They come to the gardens, book the gardens of maize from our farmers, our peasant farmers in advance, and buy from them in the garden. So the farmers here don't have to go to Kenya to take their goods, you know. But the Kenyans who want goods, they will come up to the farm and book your maize from the local farmers and even give them advance in terms of money. So what we need to do now to ensure people benefit is to form a cooperative or an association where we have better bargaining prices for the products of our people. Not for people from Rwanda, from Kenya, Tanzania to come and buy the maize here at 300 shillings, when actually they're going to sell it at more than 2,000 in their other partner states. So for the common man, they're already benefiting because these trucks come here and buy these goods and take them. So our role is to ensure that if a man is coming with a truck from Rwanda, he should not be disturbed in terms of borders, crossing, should not be disturbed in terms of finding they're disturbing your car, they're disturbing your movement. That's what we are fighting as members of Parliament of East Africa. But also, if it comes to importation of goods, if you look at now the issue of goods, these goods come for the common man. If we bring sugar, if we bring anything to be used by Ugandans, to be sold, it is not eaten only by the rich people. For example, if you bring electronics from China, isn't it? These electronics are going to be sold to the common man,
consumed by
the local person. If you bring rice from Tanzania, it's going to be consumed finally by the local man. So our role is to ensure those who are bringing those goods from those countries are not disturbed on the way. At the beginning of last year, in May, April, Uganda exported more goods to Kenya than Kenya exported to Uganda. We beat them in terms of the exports, but majorly it was agricultural products. So what you're saying that is very important, and which the president actually has put emphasis on, is the import substitution strategy, import substitution and export promotion. And I think it's going to be the main theme of the next 5 years. Even our manifesto of NRM is going to be based on how do we have import substitution and export promotion. We export more and substitute what we import by having our own industries. So as we talk now, you know that we are making our own tires. We used to import tires. But in Kapeka, the factory which is in Nakaseke, our tires are very cheap and very good. So if people are doing, if people are building, most of them are buying these tails locally. Tails which were being imported and were being sold at 35,000, they are now selling them at 18,000. So Ugandans have actually now that is what they call the import substitution, because we are putting an industry here. If you look at the steel rolling mills, if you look at the iron bars, all these products that we are producing, the cement, instead of importing cement from Kenya, we are now having a lot of our cement ourselves here. If you look at the fertilizer, the phosphates industries, if you look at most of these products actually now, we are actually manufacturing them locally here. So I thank the NRM government, I thank the president of Uganda. We have done exceptionally very well, I'm sure, and even Ugandans know that we are now manufacturing most of our products actually. Even medicines, like ARVs, you know that ARVs are being manufactured here locally by Quality Chemicals instead of importing them from Europe. Drugs are being manufactured locally here. So I think we are on the right trajectory, and I'm sure that with Yoweri Kaguta Museveni, our president, in power, since we are going to vote him, and I'm confident that we are going to win massively with this time over 70%, in the next 5 years are going to be very, very interesting for Uganda.
Mr. Dennis, we've heard that in Rwanda they've started manufacturing phones. And here in Uganda, our companies, Kila, have started manufacturing vehicles. They said that Ugandan products are very expensive than products coming from outside. When products are manufactured here, they are being on a high price compared to other products from different countries.
I don't think that one is entirely true, because for example, if I give you an example of tiles, I told you the tiles which are coming from abroad, a square meter is 35,000, but here in Uganda the tiles we are manufacturing at 18,000. So there's no way that you can have a local product here and it's more expensive than a foreign product. If we start producing our petroleum, our oil, certainly it will be cheaper here instead of importing it from abroad. Why? Because the taxes are not there for crossing when they are coming from abroad. So certainly it should be able to be cheaper.
Now, as we are soon to wind up, How are you planning to connect Uganda and Democratic Republic of Congo, especially in Ibunyoro region? We are neighboring Congo here in Ndega sub-county within Kagadi district, and we've heard that there is in Bunia here there is a very good market of our produce like maize, beans and whatever. Rather than transporting them to Kampala and then to Congo, yes, why can't we have a channel here at least to connect to Congo? How do you see?
Very true. That one is, I think even in the next 5 years, the maritime, the government is going to put seriousness and more money in the maritime, in the ships which are going to be on our lakes. But most importantly, you know, if you already this road of Muhoro Ndaiga,
yes,
I was told it's already at procurement level. They are looking at design. They are designing the road. It's going to be tarmacked. And the president has been talking about it for a very long time. They're going to tarmac that road to Ndaiga. So once we connect with Ndaiga by tarmac, then certainly the trade on Lake Albert would have been opened, which our people from Congo are coming this side, and then our products will be able to go to Congo. So, and I can assure you, don't worry about the water. Our people know how to maneuver with the water.
Yes.
They have canoes, they have ships. They will build ships which are going to go in that water because there's a need. Once the problem is the infrastructure, the road, which is connecting us with Ndaiga. Once that road is done, trade will be open.
In a minute, as we end up also, what is something new you've seen from other countries apart from Uganda, Kenya, Rwanda, Tanzania, Burundi? What are some of the new things that are not here in Uganda? I think you've traveled.
Yes, I've traveled, and I can assure you I've traveled all over the world. I have traveled everywhere, but our country certainly is the best.
The best.
Without a doubt. You cannot tell me to stay in another country. Even if you give me money, I cannot accept it. Our country is the best, and every country has its own priorities.
Yes.
Every country has its own priorities, so you'll find the priority of Kenya is not the same with Uganda. So, and we're all going at different stages. I saw when they were saying that Tanzania is a middle-income country, but well, if you compare our people here in Uganda, the standards of living of our people with our brothers from Tanzania, I think Uganda were much, much better. This is a country where you cannot easily lack food if people were serious with it, that the food is there. But there are some areas in Tanzania where you cannot get food. So an average Ugandan is doing well under the leadership of the NRM and of President Yoweri Museveni.
Okay, last word to our viewers.
Well, I want to thank our viewers for viewing us. And I want to thank our TV, and we thank you for this initiative. It's very important. I want to tell our viewers, please, as we conclude, continue supporting the National Resistance Movement under the wise leadership of Yoweri Kaguta Museveni. We are going into the last phase now of looking for votes for our president, and we have no doubt whatsoever that these others who are trying to come and contest, they are just really, they are just jokers. They think politics is a game of just coming and you say, I want, without a clear strategy. That's why the opposition is disorganized. They have failed even to get a single candidate to run against our general. They cannot manage. Each of them has their own interests, selfish interests. And I want to urge Ugandans to continue supporting the National Resistance Movement, support Yoweri Kaguta Museveni for the survival of our people, for the continued development of our people, and to ensure we put our country into the middle-income status as soon as possible. And please stay safe. observe the rules of Minister of Health to ensure that we don't get coronavirus. So please stay safe. Thank you very much.
Okay.